Paltrocast.
Good day for you so far, aside from having to talk to me.
It's a good day. I'm glad to be home.
I can imagine. Are you still based in San Diego these days?
No, I've been in Nashville for 15 years.
Oh, wow. I'll mention how, but I always heard that you were a San Diego guy. But going back to it, 50th anniversary of You Don't Mess Around With Jim, Croce Plays Croce, et cetera. You haven't slowed down in the past couple of years in terms of gigging, but tell me what's going on right now.
Wow, there's a lot of stuff going on. There's obviously touring like crazy, but then also getting started on recording some new stuff and working on a few different documentary projects, a feature project. Just there's the, you know, business side of music I deal with, and then just living life, you know.
Right, playing and managing, which is a wonderful thing that you're able to do both successfully. Now, I first found out about you from behind the music. Was that the case for a lot of people?
I don't know. I think most people found out about me before then because I was, you know, on all those late night shows, Letterman and Conan and Tonight Show. And, you know, when my first couple albums came out, I think that was what did it. And then I was, you know, I was on tour with Taj and Ray Charles and James Brown, Aretha, and those. I think that stuff came before we put together that
and
thing.
Arguably, you were working with T-Bone Burnett before it was cool to do that.
I don't know. He was pretty cool back then. But John Simon was really the arranger on that album and was just so involved in the conducting and all of that stuff. Because we recorded it live. We did the whole album in 5 days. No overdubs, just live.
Mm-hmm. We've kind of seen some evolution in your style over the years where it seemed to me like there was a label or a producer saying, hey, sound like this. And of course, that sounds nothing like a couple of albums ago.
Yeah.
Are you finally comfortable with, you know, your sound when it comes to making albums that you're not taking all that outside input?
You know, I love collaboration and sometimes it works well and it suits me and sometimes it doesn't. And so you don't know until you're a little further along in a project or finished it or it's mastered. And you're like, oh God, you know, after so many records that I've been in the studio to record, it's I'm pretty comfortable there now. And I think part of that comes with age. And part of that is that I kind of know what I'm doing there. And I think there's a facet of wanting to always stretch and do new things. If I were doing the same thing and I knew what the next one was going to sound like, I don't think I'd want to do it. I'd get bored of it, you know, and I've jumped through different genres and all kinds of things. And I think as a songwriter, that's a pretty natural thing to do. It's a song and it can be interpreted 100 different ways or more, you know, anyone that does it is going to interpret it slightly different. And I think as a performing artist, you're expected to just stick to one genre, right, not go outside of that. And so that's a little bit, you know, that's a little bit challenging, but I understand it. You know, people want to know what they're getting when they pick up your music, and that makes sense.
It seems like this point in your career, you have three different shows you can do. You could do the Croce Plays Croce. You could do the, here's all the singles and the songs you saw me do on the late night shows and were the singles and the hits. And then you can have the third, this is what I really want to play set.
Absolutely. Well, you know, the 50th anniversary show is a little bit different. This particular one is celebrating You Don't Mess Around With Jim. So that's going to be... that's going to be really two sets. The first set is completely focused on the album from beginning to end. That's what the program is. And there's great, you know, video interaction and all of the things going on with that. So it's a bit bigger show, more people on stage, you know, more people involved in it. And so I'm really looking forward to that in the fall. You know, there's a good chance because of the demand for that, that it'll stretch into next year. It's just looking that way. But next year brings around the other two albums, which will be celebrating 50th anniversaries, you know, for my father. So that's kind of likely to be part of it down the road as well. And then the Croce Plays Croce is really fun because it can change every night. And that has, you know, it has the hits, like you mentioned. But I have a lot of freedom to move things around in it because it's my music and the music of my father, but also the music that connects us. And that music is really diverse. And so, you know, it can be an old blues song. It could be an old folk song, an old rock and roll song, R&B, soul music. You know, all different kinds of stuff.
You answered about four questions right there. Because the press release I originally got said tour dates going up into late May. So you're looking ahead to 2023, 2024. Sounds like you're optimistic about the future.
I am. You know, I think there's a lot going on. There's a, you know, there's a documentary that some folks are making about me right now and just my career. And I think also the connection that I've had with music. Of course, my father will be touched on in the documentary, as will my mother and life in general. And I think that, you know, I think that with all of these different things that are working at the same time, plus recording and, you know, releasing new albums and working on new projects and collaborations. Yeah, I gotta stay optimistic for the future or else.
Well, it's wonderful handling of the estate. There's other estates that I can think of without naming names where maybe they jumped at the opportunity to cash in a little too quickly. Maybe they're not doing the right anniversaries. 50 years, if you didn't do that, that would be an absolute D minus F of an estate right there.
Well, you know, fortunately, there's I've been working with some really good people in the last 5 or 6 years, both for my career, but also for the administering the publishing and the folks that own the masters for my dad's stuff have been wonderful to work with. And that wasn't the case before. It was like pulling teeth to get them to reissue vinyl. It was pulling teeth to even get them to reissue the albums in their entirety. And so it's finally at a place where we're all working together as a team, and that was really hard to do. So, you know, there were things that were missed, opportunities that were missed in the past that I had no control over, unfortunately, even if I wanted to do something. But also, you know, next January would be my father's 80th. So there's things like that. There's going to be, I was just in Philadelphia for a CBS Sunday Morning interview and got to visit my childhood home in Lindell. And during that conversation, I was letting folks know that there's a lot of great demos and live performances that we have that will be sort of coming out slowly over the next couple years too. Great. So there's a lot of music. Most of the songs people know, not all of them, but great early recordings of them, just at home. And some of them solo, some of them with Mari Mulies in it. And so it's really kind of exciting, I think, for the fans out there who already have everything, you know?
Well, we touched upon earlier that you do have San Diego roots. And seeing when your first record deal was, I was curious if you had any interactions with the members of Rat and or Jason Sheff from Chicago in those early days.
So there was a friend of mine whose brother was in Rat. Of course, the people I was more connected with in San Diego were the connections to Tom Waits and the connection where he's from. And my teacher was Francis Thumb, one of my music teachers in high school, who had collaborated a lot with Tom Waits on a couple of plays and many, many songs over the years. So there was that connection. Jason Scheff and I went to the same high school, but he's a little bit older than I am. Mm-hmm. But I played with his father. My very first session in Nashville was when I was 17. May Axton had heard me play. May Axton was wrote Heartbreak Hotel for Elvis and was, you know, big down here in the music business for many, many years. And she called up Cowboy Jack Clement and said, "You got to hire this kid," you know, and he did. And I got there and it was Elvis's band. I walked in, Jerry Lee Lewis walked out, and, you know, it was Ron Tutt on drums. It was James Burton on guitar.
Wow. The TCG, you know, band.
Yeah. And, you know, Chef was on bass. So, I've never met Jason Scheff, but I met his dad.
Wow. When I interviewed Jason Scheff, I had to ask that same question. He's like, "Oh yeah, me and Robin Crossey from Rat were in competing cover bands."
And oh, that's funny.
You never know when the San Diego scene goes. I mean, Blink-182 came out of there as well. That band Convoy that became Louis XIV came out of there.
Sure.
For all I know, you were going to go, "Oh, I produced the original Blink-182 demo."
Oh, no, it's funny. San Diego, it was a pretty small music scene, but because of the proximity to LA, it was easy to go up and play, you know, and so, you know, there were a lot of different artists. Also, it was a nice place to live for a lot of more established artists who just wanted a quieter life, you know. Mm-hmm. And it was the proximity to LA that really brought my family there in the first place. It was just quieter, and the airport was right in the center of town and potentially easy for my father to get to LA and anywhere else he would need to go. And so at the time it was, a quiet beach town. And the musicians in San Diego, like a lot of cities, that size, there's enough work for most people to make a living playing music. I mean, you have to hustle, I think. But also there wasn't a real competitive thing that I saw. You know, it didn't matter whether, you know, I was friends with guys in Rocket from the Crypt, and I was friends.
Oh, yeah.
And I was friends with some of the guys in Convoy and then the guys, one, a couple of the guys in Convoy started Dirty Sweet, which was on my label. And so there were, and then, you know, Jewel was there, and there was Pulse and Gregory Page and Jason Mraz. And there wasn't a competition between all of these people and their genres. You know, it was kind of like, everyone was happy for everyone else's success. And rarely, you know, you rarely saw anyone because everyone that was doing it touring internationally that wasn't a local band was always gone, you know? And J.J. Cale was there, and there was just a really diverse mix of musicians that were there, and a lot of great jazz musicians from New York and LA had settled there. It was nice, but it took a lot of work and dedication and focus to be able to write every day, write songs every day, and practice every day, because when it's perfect outside, it's hard not to go outside.
Right.
And so staying in a little room with, you know, with my piano or guitar or whatever became, it was challenging. And, you know, being that it's not Los Angeles, it became something I had to trek up there and back, you know, once a week for a period of time. So that was a challenge. And I love LA, but But you know, it's a big city, you know, and the quality of life here in Nashville is just, it's so much easier, you know, and there's so many genres of music here, you mm-hmm. know, I mean, just tons of different things.
Right. Well, two quick questions and then you're a free man. And the first one comes from absolutely nowhere, but when you're managing a legendary catalog like you are, it veers into classic rock territory. I was wondering if there were any encounters related to Van Halen.
No. I'm not connected with them in any fashion. I mean, you know, entertainment is funny in that way because, you know, you end up either on a festival with other acts that may not be in quite the same genre as you, and you end up, you know, hanging out all day or something. I mean, or you end up meeting because of travel. Like I used to fly, you know, I remember flying to play at the North Sea Jazz Festival in Holland. And obviously all of these groups on the plane were not playing, but two of us were. Lou Rawls was on the plane and his
band. Yeah.
And then it was, and then there was Obituary, and then there was my band, and then there was Christian Death. And it's like, you know, Obituary and Christian Death were not playing the North Sea Jazz Festival, but we talked the whole time, you know? And then right. at the festival, just curiously, Lou Rawls needed a piano player, wanted to do a Sam Cooke song. And someone grabbed me and we went over and I went over and played on his thing. So that stuff happens with all kinds of music that you wouldn't necessarily expect.
Yeah, let's face it, touring musicians, comics, actors, put them in an airport long enough and they can find some common ground. So,
oh, absolutely. Being an entertainer, regardless of what style of entertainer, whether it's comedy or acting or being a musician, regardless of genre, you live a very similar life. And you have a lot in common just based on the kind of work and the kind of work you do and don't do. And so I think there's always something, you know, you have in common with other people that do what you do.
Mm-hmm. And my last question, putting you on the spot here, what is your favorite Jim Croce deep cut that you don't think enough people listen to that should have been a hit that they should be listening to like it's a hit?
Tomorrow's going to be a brighter day. I think that is probably right off the top of my head. There's two, Box Number 10 and Tomorrow's going to be a brighter day, but Tomorrow's going to be a brighter day. It just seems like it could have been a hit song. It just kind of got overlooked. Mm-hmm. And I've over the years, I've tried to put those two songs in compilations whenever I've had the chance to, or been involved in doing that with the label, because they're just such great songs. Paltrocast.